Hello, History 363. So we are coming to the end. So we left off with the assassination of Julius Caesar in the Senate House on the Ides of March, 44 BC. A conspiracy led by a group of senators centered around Marcus Junius Brutus and Cassius Longinus. And these senators really haven't thought much about what happens after Caesar is dead. They may kind of blithely believe that with the death of Caesar, the Republic will just sort of return to normal. And what they instead find as they leave the Senate House expecting cheers and jubilation is a sort of dread-filled silence. Even though with the death of the dictator, the Republic does start to muddle forward. Still, Caesar's death has led a huge vacuum that different sort of people with some kind of power base are trying to fill. I would note that the conspirators themselves hang out in Rome. There's no attempt to prosecute them until riots and protests, particularly sort of sponsored by Mark Antony, cause them to leave to the east. Where Brutus at least has a sort of minor provincial assignment. That said, the people who sort of can step in to fill this void, for one, Mark Antony. Mark Antony, who has been Caesar's longtime sort of supporter, lieutenant, is the consul. He had been consul with Caesar for 44 BC. And so Caesar's dead, Mark Antony is still the consul. And of course, this puts him in a pretty good position to act. He literally has official powers that he can exercise. Of course, his big goal is, knowing that he's going to cease being consul by the end of 44, is to get himself a province. So he has a law passed in July assigning him the province of Cisalpine Gaul and Transalpine Gaul. One problem for him is there's already a provincial governor in Cisalpine Gaul who, as we'll see, doesn't want to leave his province. That being said, Antony doesn't, say, immediately try to purge the conspirators, even though sometimes his comportment in public, including, it seems, at times being drunk in public, offends many of the senators. Now, another potential sort of power figure is Cicero. Cicero is, at this point, the most sort of distinguished senior politician on hand. And while Cicero had sided with Pompey and indeed been pardoned by Caesar, he still has, again, this great claim of having eliminated the Catilinian conspiracy. He's kind of the last living senior Roman politician, outside of Pompey and Caesar, of course, they're both dead, to potentially be able to kind of fill this void. So he's going to be emerging as a very important leader in the Senate, indeed, this sees sort of an efflorescence of Cicero as a sort of thought leader and orator. In particular, Cicero is hostile to Mark Antony, and starting in late 44, he's going to give a series of speeches against Mark Antony, starting with denouncing his sort of loutish conduct, and then ultimately advocating for Antony to be outlawed and for the Senate and the Republic to make war against him. These are the Philippics. They take that title after a series of speeches that the great Athenian orator, Demosthenes, had given, warning Athens about the dangers of the king Philip II. So the idea of calling these speeches Philippics harkens to the idea that Antony is a tyrant, is a would-be monarch, is a menace to the free state. There is then one figure who emerges maybe as a bit of a surprise, and that is Caesar's 19-year-old great-nephew, whose name is Gnaeus Octavius. The surprise is, while Gnaeus Octavius had sort of been brought as a young man into Caesar's orbit, Caesar names him as his adopted son in his will. And of course, this kind of shocks Mark Antony. Mark Antony may have secretly hoped that he would be named Caesar's adopted son in his will, and is shocked that this great nephew, which again, I think for us, we would probably today say a great nephew is kind of a distant relation. It's the same for the Romans. To be someone's great nephew is a very faint connection But that's all Caesar's got, because again, Caesar only had one child, Julia. She dies dies in childbirth, but without producing a child. So Caesar is sort of going down the line to find a relative, and as this great nephew, Gnaeus Octavius, is really the only one who's there. So now, with the adoption, he no longer goes around calling himself Gnaeus Octavius. He actually can go around calling himself, "Hi, I'm Julius Caesar." We refer to him at this phase in his life as Octavian. That is, by the sort of Roman nomenclature of adoption, he would be Gaius Julius Caesar Octavianus. Realizing the magic in his name, Octavian essentially kind of starts courting Caesar's veterans and some of the troops that are still sort of standing by in Brundisium. You know, having been stationed there, ready to go off for Caesar's aborted Parthian campaign, and of course, this now gives Octavian his own power base. That he has this connection with Caesar's veterans and troops that no one else has, because no one else can actually say, "I'm Caesar's son," and by the way, my name is Julius Caesar. Things sort of break down in 43 when Antony, whose consulship is over, wants to go to his province of Cisalpine Gaul, finds that the governor of that province, Decius Brutus, is saying, "I won't leave." And he's sort of now, there's a lot, everyone is kind of acting like a warlord these days. And so Antony therefore goes to war with Brutus, blockading him up in the town of Mutina. So the whole series of military operations that are going to transpire are sometimes referred to as the Mutine War. Now, while this is happening, Cicero has managed to convince the Senate to take this opportunity of this petty warlord battle between Mark Antony and Decius Brutus, different from our Marcus Junius Brutus, by the way, to declare Antony an outlaw and have the Senate declare war on him. And so this happens. The two consuls are sent for that year are sent up against Antony in order to recruit as many of Caesar's troops, Octavian tags along. He's sort of the Cicero at this point thinks that Octavian can be a kind of useful avatar, too young to really be dangerous. Cicero can kind of flatters himself, thinking that he's going to be kind of a father figure to this young boy whose own father has passed away. And of course, it's Cicero who's kind of deluding himself. Antony is ultimately defeated and forced to retreat across to Transalpine Gaul. In the process, however, both of the consuls are killed. Octavian says, "Well, we need new consuls." And he says, "I want to be named. I want to be made the next consul." The Senate isn't quite willing to commit, and so Octavian goes back to Rome with about 8 legions in tow and enters into Rome without violence, but with his army clearly there to menace everybody, and is elected consul for 43. Will be the first of 13 consulships for Octavian, and of course eventually takes the name Augustus. Octavian is now consul, meanwhile, technically, still at war with Antony. However, in the October of that year, to everyone's surprise, a shocking announcement is made, namely that Octavian and Antony make peace, and they agree to cooperate with each other. They have a third partner in what's going to be basically a military junta. And that is Aemilius Lepidus, who actually seems to be a key figure in arranging this whole thing. This Aemilius Lepidus is the son of the Aemilius Lepidus, the consul, who back in 78 had led a revolt against the Sullan reforms. They coerce a law that is passed, the Lex Titia, that proclaims them triumviri, re publicae constituendi, 3 men for the reconstitution of the Res Publica. This is a completely kind of extra constitutional position, but it gives them essentially as a junta, as a board, basically dictatorial powers, with the only limit on their power being a 5-year block in which they can exercise it. With this power, do have some rivals, namely Marcus, Junius Brutus, and Cassius have gone east. They have essentially, in this whole time while they were, Octavian and Antony were fighting around Mutina and while they're organizing their triumvirate, Brutus and Cassius have won over the loyalty of most of the governors in the east, and now have a large army, which they basically claim represents the true republic against these three, military dictators, against this military junta. Technically, a law has already been passed in 44 banning the office of dictatorship. These against the triumvirs. The triumvirs therefore need to raise an army and go east to fight Brutus and Cassius, the tyrannicides, as they're sometimes known. But first they need money. And to get money, they fall back on the old sullen device of prescriptions, also a way to liquidate anyone who they think might be an enemy. Here actually, it's worth just taking a pause. One person who had not done prescriptions was Julius Caesar. Julius Caesar, who, while proclaiming himself eventually sort of dictator in perpetuity, seems to have really recoiled as someone who's very much on the Marian side of things, had recoiled from the violent excesses of Sulla and had consciously, as part of his self-presentation, had tried to avoid that. Indeed, the key word of Caesar's sort of post-Civil War settlement had always been clemency, clementia, that anyone who wanted a pardon from Caesar simply had to ask for it and Caesar would grant it. There would be no wholesale liquidation of rivals under Caesar. Now, it's possible you could say that this clementia is something that causes Caesar his life, as a number of the people who take part in the conspiracy have previously been pardoned by him. That being said, there will be no clementia under the triumvirs. Indeed, Octavian in particular, his key word is vengeance, avenging the murder of his father, his adoptive father, Julius Caesar. And Mark Antony and Lepidus also have enemies that they want liquidated. And of course, they need the money from the prescriptions to fund the huge army that they're going to raise and fight, go to the east to fight the tyrannicides. There are stories that the triumvirs sort of do kind of, baseball card trades amongst each other. I really want to kill him. Oh, no, he can't kill him. He's, my aunt's cousin's, friend. And so they sort of negotiate with each other about, the enemy of one might be an ally of another. Antony, however, has one unconditional demand for prescription, and that is Cicero. Cicero has given this whole series of philippics against Antony, Antony has taken much of this personally, and Antony absolutely demands that Cicero be prescribed, and Cicero kind of delays fleeing. He flees but is hunted down and killed. His head is cut off and his hand is cut off, and they are nailed to the rostra, where Cicero has given so many speeches. And this is ultimately the brutal and bloody end of, again, one of the most famous orators of the late Republic and one of the greatest statesmen of the period, just liquidated in this horrific prescription. In 42, Brutus and, in 42, Antony and Octavian go east to confront Brutus and Cassius. And the great battle is fought near Philippi in Greece. We're not going to go into the military details. We don't have time. It's really kind of two battles. Notably, in the first battle, Brutus beats Octavian. Octavian, who really has never engaged in any kind of military command, is beaten, and he himself has to flee and spend some time supposedly hiding in a swamp. Antony, however, in the same battle, though kind of being fought on different parts of the battlefield, defeats Cassius, who commits suicide, and then subsequently both forces converge and crush Brutus. So with that, the tyrannicides are dead, and there is really no force that is available to possibly stop the triumvirs. There is one force that can cause them some hassle, and that is Sextus Pompey, the last surviving son of Pompey the Great, who has managed to position himself between Massilia and Sicily, and who has a fleet and troops. Again, not enough to really overthrow the triumvirs, but enough that if he wants to, he can cut off the supply of grain to Rome, something that will not make the triumvirs very popular from a hungry Roman populace. So after the Battle of Philippi, 42, Octavian goes back to Italy, where he is going to focus on discharging and settling as many veterans as possible, again, mostly in Italy. And this actually proves really tough, because again, the triumvirs, they have some land that they've got from prescriptions, but to settle veterans, they also just simply take people's land. They confiscate and say, well, we're giving it to our veterans. And this, of course, is profoundly unpopular. Some of this land is coming from the kind of political class in Rome, people whose opinion kind of matters, or just have the ability to elucidate public opinion. And it's also coming even just from common peasants or small farmers or people with modest plots are threatened with losing either some or all of their land to accommodate the triumviral veterans. This is making Octavian very, very, very unpopular. Antony, meanwhile, is going to stay in the east, essentially to settle affairs. And amongst other things, in Tarsus, he has a diplomatic meeting with the Hellenistic queen of Egypt, Cleopatra VII. We've already met her, of course. And they it seems at this point they initiate a sexual relationship that will eventually, over time, produce three children. In 40, Antony comes back, and it actually seems at this point that relations between Antony and Octavian are deteriorating. One key point of contention is Antony's governor. Antony has been left. He's got all the eastern provinces that he's arranging affairs after the Battle of Philippi. But he's still been the governor of Transalpine and Cisalpine Gaul. But the legate that Antony has left has died, and Octavian has installed his own guy, basically usurping Antony's provinces in the west. And this has been obviously a point of real contention. And so when Antony lands at Brundisium in 40, it looks like the two are about to go to war. And in fact, there's been this bizarre in 41, while Antony is away, there's been this bizarre war around Perusia in which Antony's brother and Antony's wife, Fulvia, try to lead some kind of revolt against Octavian and his governance of Italy. This is the Perusian War. It ends when Lucius Antony, or Lucius Antonius, the Mark Antony's brother, and Fulvia are ultimately forced to surrender. They are spared, although Fulvia seems to die shortly afterwards. But Octavian has executed a number of the supporters. So what were Fulvia and Lucius Antonius doing? Did Mark Antony approve of what they were doing? Did they just think he would approve? Were they just hoping to overthrow Octavian on their own kind of adventure? It's hard to say. But this Perusian War obviously further leads to bad blood between Octavian and Augustus compiling the sort of usurpation of Gaul. So it looks like they're going to fight a civil war in Brundisium when Antony lands. Both sides have their armies. They're encamped near each other. And the soldiers won't fight. They mutiny. And so a instead of a war, we have the Pact of Brundisium, which basically reaffirms the relationship, but changes the territorial allotments. Octavian is now basically going to get much of the West, so he's Spain, Gaul, Cisalpine Gaul, and while Italy is sort of technically going to be kind of neutral, Octavian, because he's in Rome, is basically going to be controlled out as well. Lepidus, who is already becoming a third wheel at this point, will have Africa, and then Antony will get will govern the East. So the Pact of Brundisium reaffirms these relationships, these arrangements, and also, as a way of sealing this pact, Antony marries Octavian's sister, Octavia. So now we have a new marriage connection between Antony and Octavian. Even though, Antony goes back to the East, he will resume his connection with Cleopatra as well. All right, so with the Pact of Brundisium in 40 BC, I think we're going to leave it for here for now. Next time, we will look at the breakup of the Second Triumvirate and ultimately the civil war between Mark Antony and Octavian. So we'll see you soon.